great British explorer George Mallory was to die on Mount Everest, was asked why did he want to climb it. He said because it is there.
So in 1962, then President Kennedy announced at Rice University in Texas the goal of sending humans to the moon and returning them safely to Earth within that decade. And of course, we sort of take it as a given that, you know, the president said it, it became a national initiative, vast amounts of money were spent. But in fact, one of the things that had to happen was a large number of policymakers and taxpayers all had to be persuaded that this was a good idea. Well, in August of 1963, about 11 months after Kennedy made his historic speech in Texas, two NASA scientists by the name of Newell and Jastrow wrote a little booklet which was distributed very widely among policymakers and to anyone in the public who was interested, and basically posed the question, why should we land on the moon? Why was this worth a vast amount of money? And there were three principal lines of argument that are discussed in this little booklet. One, of course, has to do with the national interest, national security, national prestige. We were in the midst of the Cold War, and the space race with the Soviet Union was at that moment, in 1962 and then in 1963, still being lost. The Soviet Union had been the first to space with a satellite. They'd been the first to space with an animal, a living animal, a dog. They had been the first to space with an astronaut, and administration was looking for an initiative that was something that the U.S. could win in the space race, because that would demonstrate that the U.S. Socioeconomic system was competitive and was superior to communism. So first and foremost, national interest, national prestige, demonstrating that the U.S. was a superior system. Secondly, as Kennedy mentioned in his speech, we do these things not because they are easy, but because they are hard. And the pursuit of the space race and the pursuit of the Apollo program would lead to tremendous technical innovation in aerospace technologies and computing and materials and all these technologies that were of great value both in the Cold War and for the future of the United States. And lastly, for science. Because there was at that time still a big question about how was the moon formed? What is the relationship between the moon and the Earth? What was the earliest origins of our solar system, and how did the Earth and the moon get affected by the impacts that came from deep space? All of those things were unknown. Well, all of those questions were addressed, and all of those technologies were developed. The space race was won. Missions took place. So why are we talking now about going back to the moon? Well, there are really three principal reasons, again. First and foremost, there's been a fundamental change in our understanding of the moon in the last 10 or 15 years based on the discovery that there is, in fact, vast amounts of water in the form of ices and hydrated minerals at the north and south pole of the moon. One of the things we learned from Apollo was that the moon was bone dry and always would be and always had been. There was no water, no hydrogen, no oxygen, no way to make life support materials, no way to make rocket fuels and so on. Turned out none of that was true, and there is in fact a vast amount of water at the poles of the moon where it's cold. Second big change, right now there is a revolution going on in space launch systems technology, driven in large measure by two firms, SpaceX and Blue Origin, both of which are developing new launchers which will deliver payloads to space and therefore to the moon at a 90% cost reduction from the cost of getting into space and getting to the moon compared to the glory days of Apollo and the space shuttle. That changes everything. And lastly, and I use this these metaphors, and lastly, there's been tremendous advances in a wide range of technologies here on Earth, which allow large numbers of 3D printed, technically modular, rapidly reconfigurable, intelligent systems to be mass-produced all over the world. If you've ever seen a little CubeSat, or you've seen, or if you have one of these things in your pocket, then you are enjoying the mobile phone. You're enjoying the benefits of mass-produced, modular, digitally reconfigurable systems. This changes how we return to the moon and what we can do there and at what price. As a consequence of water on the moon, new launch systems, lower prices, new technologies, a vast number of countries and companies are now all planning to go to the moon. And so one reason we now is the time to go to the moon is because everybody else is also going, and they're going for the purposes of exploring, finding those resources, developing those resources, and using them not only for the operations on the moon, which is kind of a self-eating watermelon. We go to the moon to get resources to operate on the moon. It's not really useful. But in addition, finding materials on the moon like water ice, using the other resources of the moon, silicon, aluminum, iron, and so on, to manufacture things, print things, 3D printing on the moon affordably, will allow us to basically use the moon as a stepping stone to the rest of the solar system and to introduce lunar resources in the form of manufactured things into a larger near-Earth economy, including the delivery of energy, solar energy harvested in space, to the markets on Earth in tremendous quantities and in completely carbon-neutral fashion during the coming decades. Moreover, we go back to the moon because it is a tremendous testbed for new technologies, a research and development lab. We can use it, as shown in the lower left, lower right image, as a testbed for going back to Mars. So it's a tremendous R&D lab because it's going to be cheaper to get there, because we'll have the resources to be there in a sustainable fashion. And operations in near-Earth space on orbital platforms will basically open the gateway, pun intended, for a current NASA program on this level, to the rest of the solar system. Just going and being on the moon is not the same as being able to go anywhere in the solar system. That becomes possible. And lastly, we go back to the moon because it is a tremendous platform for doing astronomy and for observing our universe that we in ways that we cannot achieve here on Earth. And finally, we go back to the moon to stay. There is no better place in our solar system where we might consider the creation of a sustainable Earth-like habitat than at the north and the south pole of the moon, where we have basically the same amount of energy, we have the same kind of minerals, we have some shortcomings, but the discovery of water fundamentally changes the opportunity for human settlement of the moon. And ultimately, we do all these things not individually, not in a race, but we do them because we have the opportunity to do them together. We have the opportunity to do all of these things, development of the moon's resources, delivery of energy for Earth, sustainable settlements in space in the form of a village as a metaphor. Not in a race, but rather doing these things all together. And I think that many of the students here at Laguna Blanca will be part of these programs and these efforts over the coming years. Thank you very much.